Good morning and a warm welcome to the seventh meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2024. Our first agenda item is a decision taking business in private. Are members content to take item four in private? Thank you very much. Our second agenda item is for the committee to choose a deputy convener. The Parliament has agreed that only members of the Scottish Conservative and Unionist Party are eligible for nomination as deputy convener. I understand Alexander Stewart, MSP, is the party's nominee. Does any member disagree with this nomination? Thank you very much. I congratulate Alexander Stewart on his appointment as deputy convener of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee. Well done. And agenda item three is our ongoing review of the EU-UK Trade Cooperation Agreement inquiry. And we are joined virtually this morning. And I wonder if I could ask our panel to introduce themselves. If we go to Jannike first.
Yes, good morning. Thank you for the invitation. My name is Jannike Wachowiak and I'm a researcher at the UK in a Changing Europe think tank.
Thank you. And Joel?
Morning, everyone. I'm Joël Roland. I'm a research associate at UK in a Changing Europe.
Okay. A very warm welcome to you both, and thank you very much for the report, which the committee have all been made aware of before today's session. And I'd like to ask a couple of questions about the report. You suggest that there's two key factors that shape the TCA review. One is political will, which we talk about quite a lot in this committee, and the other is the process of how the review will take place. Which do you think is the more dominant in terms of how things are likely to go going forward, given the election cycles and everything else? Jannike, do you want to go first?
Yes, sure. I think at the end of the day, the politics will probably shape the process. So I think that the politics are the more important factor. If you look at the review clause in the TCA, the wording is very vague. So it is really up to the two parties to decide what how they want to conduct the review. All that we know is that it is a review of the implementation of the agreement and not the agreement itself. We know the timing, which is 2026, so 5 years after entry into force of the agreement. And we know that there is no agreed process. So I think the process is going to be important, and our report outlines kind of three options of how the review could unfold potentially. But I think in terms of choosing one of those options, the politics is going to be very important.
Joel?
Yeah, I agree with Jannike. It's ultimately about the politics. As you say, we kind of have the broad outlines that a review could take, but it's up to both sides jointly to agree. That's the key point. They need to be in agreement on it. So it's about kind of where you can find a political middle ground. And I think it's also worth saying that the review is only as useful as either side wants it to be. Because if you have, say, a scenario where both a UK government and the European Commission both actually want to quite substantively review the terms of the TCA, they don't have to use the review. It's kind of, you know, there are a number of different ways that you could go about it. You could just kind of ad hoc pursue agreements to deepen what you have or to add new element to the agreement. So the review is, yeah, as useful as either side wants it to be. You could say, okay, we're going to take this point in 2026 as kind of a political moment, so to speak, around which we're going to structure our negotiations, but it doesn't have to be done that way. And it feels at the moment like the review is being used in political discourse as a way to point to the future horizon, saying, particular party saying, we want to deepen the relationship and we have this review as an opportunity, but no one has really thought about the details. So it's still a political instrument for demonstrating will, and no one has really got to the point of thinking, okay, if we do want to go deeper, do we need to use the review or do we want to pursue it through other forms?
I guess what we saw after the Windsor Agreement was that some of these issues were resolved in terms of Horizon funding and things like that. Exactly as you say, Joel, it doesn't have to be waiting for the review or part of that process as it's written. But we had the farming sector in last week, and they think that trying to resolve the SPS issue in veterinary agreements will be quite time consuming or quite difficult to do. And you mentioned the phrase, I think it's Brexit fatigue, in the report a few times. Do you think that some of the big substantive issues that are still a key concern, certainly from the UK point of view, do you see any of those having traction in Europe going forward before the review cycle?
Do you mean on SPS specifically?
Yeah, well, SPS as an example. So you know, that's one of the areas that is of real concern here, but may not have any traction in terms of what's happening in Europe.
Yeah, so I think kind of the point that we make clear in the review is that for the most part, the EU is quite satisfied with the agreement as it is. The kind of the trade friction which is being created by the TCA falls more heavily on the UK because it's more dependent on the EU market than vice versa. So European businesses can divert their trade to other parts of the single market where they don't face these barriers to trade. So there's more incentive for the UK to try and gain new elements such as an SPS agreement, which then comes back to the point about why it's the review is something which both parties have to take part in. I think for the UK to get the EU to listen to these things, it needs to think about incentives, because we've heard a lot about what the UK wants, the potential additions, deepenings which could take place, but how do you bring the European Union to the table? And so you need to give them something that they're also interested in negotiating. The two most obvious examples are a mobility agreement, where we know that that's a point of quite significant regret for a lot of member states, that their young people can no longer so easily come here to study or to work or to live. And also a foreign security agreement, because again, the UK is quite a significant player on that front, and it's an issue which has risen in salience over the past couple of years since Ukraine. So that is also potentially an argument for using a review, because if you want to make trade-offs, if the UK says that we would like an SPS agreement, it needs to offer something else in return. And so if you pursue an SPS negotiation in isolation, there's less incentive for the EU to conclude it, as if you say, okay, this agreement is contingent upon us also finalising the terms of mobility agreement. So that is one of the strongest arguments for having some kind of review / structured negotiation, rather than just ad hoc pursuing individual amendments to the TCA.
Okay, Yannicke, did you want to come in?
Yes. Am I unmuted?
Yeah. No, we can hear you. Thanks.
Okay, good. Sorry. Slight technical confusion. I agree with everything that Joelle has outlined. And just to add, in terms of where the EU is at the moment, I think the EU is thinking very rarely about its relationship with the UK these days. And they have lots of other pressing issues, and they, of course, also have their own elections this year, which I think, even though we've said any kind of amendments or even additional negotiations don't have to wait for the TCA review, I think the caveat is that this year, I think it's going to be very difficult to have any of those discussions, even if you have a new UK government that wants to have those discussions, but just given the fact that you have European Parliament elections in June, and then afterwards quite a lengthy process of reorganising the institutions and finding new leaders for the top jobs. And if you look at how they go about it when it comes to the European Commission, which at the end of the day manages the day-to-day relationship with the UK, you usually have hearings of commissioners throughout October. And last time, I think the new commission was in place only at the end of November 2019. So I think that will make it very difficult to have any substantive discussions this year, which then probably leads us to 2025 until those discussions can take place. I also agree with Joelle that the UK needs to think carefully about incentives, because The EU published its annual TCA implementation report last year in March, which states that this is a very good agreement for the EU, and they are fairly happy with it. And I think another factor is that this very carefully balances the interests of 27 member states. So to reopen that and risk upsetting this balance between the 27 is difficult for the EU. Also, particularly when it comes to the trading agreement in the TCA, once you kind of go back into those discussions, you have 27 individual economic interests which will have to be balanced. So I think that's why the incentives for the EU at the moment are low. When it comes to the SPS deal in particular, I think another kind of important point to keep in mind is that as long as the UK has not yet fully implemented border controls at the UK border, the incentive for the EU is quite low in this area, because whilst UK farmers have had to deal with border controls since January 2021, this has not been the case for EU farmers due to delays on the UK side. Of course, we know that physical controls are going to be implemented from the end of April, so fairly soon. So it's going to be interesting to see how that goes and whether that goes ahead as planned, because I think if once the EU side kind of experiences those border controls, there might be a bit more of an incentive for them to have a discussion about an SPS deal as well.
Thank you. I want to come to questions from the committee. I'll go to Ms. Rascal, then Ms. Forbes. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks very much, convener. I wanted to ask you about your views on the carbon border adjustment mechanism. And I suppose, you know, reading your report, there is an option here for both the UK and the EU ETSs to come into greater alignment. But it would be useful to get your views on what the current challenges are and whether those two emissions trading schemes are currently kind of moving apart from each other in terms of carbon price. So how easy would it be to kind of bring them together practically? I don't know who'd like to go on that. I think, Joel, you're nodding.
Yeah, I'm happy to go. So the kind of immediate answer is, in some senses, it's relatively easy, kind of the UK relative to other countries in the world. But in another sense, it's still difficult, because this is not a simple negotiation. It's a technical negotiation. So to deal with the easy point first, you know, the UK was formerly part of the EU's emissions trading scheme, and so its emissions trading scheme, to a large degree, resembles the EU's in terms of its scope and kind of ways of working. There's been some divergence in price. It was significant for a while, although it's now narrowing again. So, you know, relative to most countries in the world, the UK is actually quite highly aligned, although to an extent that is evolving, because both sides are updating their schemes over time, and the EU is looking to bring in new elements around transport maritime emissions. And so it will, over time, they'll diverge to a greater extent. So there's an incentive to, if you want to align, to do it sooner rather than later, before the differences become too significant. But then the more difficult part is, even if both sides sit down and say, OK, we want to try and link our emissions trading schemes, which the TCA does give a nod to as a possibility, it's still a technical process. I'd invite you to read an article on our website, which was written in September 2023 by Sam Lowe, I believe, which explains in more detail how this could work. But there's more than one option for how you link schemes. You can have kind of full alignment, where the UK effectively would have to accept quite a large degree of sort of EU autonomy over how our own emissions trading scheme would be working, what you do with the revenues which are generated, and so forth. So it's, you know, politically potentially there's a challenge around how much sort of sovereignty you're giving up and how much alignment you have to take with EU regulations. Or you can have more of a partial linking, where you have distinct markets, but you have kind of fluidity of credits between the two. That potentially, you know, is, you're less interlinked, and so potentially doesn't bring you as many benefits, but it's perhaps easier to conclude. But either way, it's going to be politically quite a difficult discussion, and also technically quite a tough discussion to conclude. So there's a clear potential benefit to this. You would avoid the bureaucracy and the tariffs which could be levied under the EU CBAM. So there's a strong incentive for traders to have that linking, but a lot of work would have to go into it from UK government.
In terms of timescale for that, I think you indicated that it took 10 years for Switzerland to strike a similar agreement to link the two ETSs together. It feels like only yesterday we were in the EU ETS. So would it really take 10 years to conclude a negotiation on this? Or would it be a lot quicker given the current alignment that we have?
It could be a lot quicker. I mean, with the EU, political will is always an important thing. Part of the reason why it took 10 years is not because there was 10 years of administration to work through. It's also to do with the politics around that. And you can look at the EU's other agreements with Switzerland, which are constantly being turned on and off. It's quite a fraught relationship as well that they have there. So if there was good political will and good political relations on both sides, you could expect that to be a lot quicker. And I think that 10-year kind of example is expectation management to a certain extent, saying this is how long it can take, but it can also be a lot quicker. And again, because the UK was in the system, was previously in the ETS, that's another reason why it could go faster. And of course, you know, potentially there's an incentive for the EU to get this concluded as well. If the UK introduces its own CBAM around the same time, I think 2027 is currently earmarked as the date. So if their businesses are suffering from the UK CBAM, that's another reason to get ETS linkage done.
Okay. And how much of a kind of lobby do you think there is from particular sectors that would be disadvantaged by the CBAM? I mean, are we seeing in Brussels a particular drive for sectors that where they're going to see, you know, huge costs imposed on export to the EU? Or I'm not sure where the political drive is for this to be a priority.
Yeah, so my understanding is, I think there was a study done saying about 6% of UK exports by value, I think, would be subject to the EU CBAM as it stands. There's a article by Peter Foster in the Financial Times last Thursday about this in his weekly column if you want to look at that. And I think the sectors that are likely to be particularly affected are steel. I think steel is probably the one that's most vulnerable to the effects. There are some others as well, obviously, but I think steel is the biggest one within that. And so, yeah, that's where the steel sector has actually already come out and criticised the UK government for being too slow in implementing its own CBAM. So there's clearly an active process ongoing with that industry in particular.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Kate.
Thanks very much, and welcome. I have a question about the evidence base, as it were, that would sort of advise on the nature of any review. And you obviously emphasise this in your report, and it's pretty obvious to all that have been watching the evolution of the TCA that there is a massive tension between political imperative and what politicians feel under pressure to do, nearly always by their own voting base, versus what a sort of general civic position might be on the best way to drive reforms. I think Horizon came out of that, but equally wouldn't have happened without political pressure. And obviously, this year is a big year from a political perspective. But I just wondered yourselves where you see the potential for the evidence base itself informing change versus straight up politics. And I guess the second part to that is we have spoken to various stakeholders, as you will have also. And if we take the farming agriculture community, they'll have a list as long as their arms of changes that they want to see. But I guess from your perspective, what do stakeholders like that feel they need to do in order to progress those changes? Is it developing evidence, or actually is that moot and irrelevant because at the end of the day it will be political pressure? Sorry, that was almost an essay of a question.
To direct it to
either.
Yannicke, do you want to go first?
Oh, I think you're on mute now.
That's okay.
You.
No, I'm muted. Yeah, happy to make a start. I think one way to feed in evidence of things that maybe aren't working well or aren't working as intended in the implementation of the TCA is to actually use the governance framework that underpins the TCA. So, of course, you have various specialized committees and trade specialized committees where the two sides meet. And they, at the moment, the frequency is around once a year. But there have been some suggestions from the House of Lords European Affairs Committee that the frequency isn't sufficient and that the two sides should be meeting more often. And in those discussions in the specialized committees, from what I know, there are usually kind of discussions with stakeholders ahead of those specialized committee meetings. So that is an opportunity to feed in any concerns. And then there are, of course, also fora like the Parliamentary Partnership Assembly and the Civil Society Forum, where civil society in particular can raise concerns. So I think just using the governance framework maybe a bit more than has been the case so far is one way of doing it. And that might then also feed through into the annual implementation report that the EU publishes, and the UK, I think, is publishing one every other year. So I think that could be a useful way of doing it. I think in terms of lobby groups in general, we've seen that that can be effective. I think you mentioned Horizon. I think another good example is the rules of origin for electric vehicles, where the EU has been very hesitant at first to amend the rules that were about to change from this year, 2024. And it took almost over a year to come to an agreement and to decide to basically delay that to the 2027. And I think a huge factor in that has been pressure from industry on both sides. So I think that might be one of the keys, that you actually have pressure from industries from both sides, so that there is a clear kind of mutual interest and also mutual benefit, and it's not just one-sided. So I think in terms of civil society, but also lobby groups, if you can kind of join forces, I think that might be an effective way of doing it.
Thanks. Has Joel dropped off the call? Oh no, he's still there. Hi.
I'm here, hi. Yeah. I agree with what Yannick has said. I think just to add, this echoes my kind of opening point really, is the process is fundamentally political. This is not a structured negotiation which is set in stone. You know, it's not like the TCA negotiations either, where you have a fixed deadline and you have a fixed number of files that you need to conclude or at least try and discuss. This is almost entirely ambiguous in its process, and therefore fundamentally is going to be driven by politics, not policy. That's kind of what's going to shape the scope of any review that takes place. And so on the EU side, you know, the real limiting constraining factor is just the lack of real appetite for deep negotiation, the focus on other things that constrains what you can do. And on the UK side, here I think we're going to assume a Labour government in this scenario, because they're the ones that are more likely to pursue a deep review. They're going to be constrained by capacity, because an incoming Labour government would have a lot of things that they'd want to do on the domestic front. And these negotiations require a lot of administrative bandwidth in themselves. And so you're limited in how much you can actually put into a TCA review, because you're going to want to be doing lots of other things in other parts of politics at the same time. So the politics of that is really going to constrain what's achievable, and it's going to be down to both sides to find their middle ground within that. There's no deadline, there's no point where they need to get it done by. So if they're actually serious about getting anything out of a review, they're going to have to, you know, get their heads together, kind of have lots of, you know, candid discussions on the margins of events where they kind of test each other's kind of perspectives out as well, kind of work around, try and build relations, try and create trust. All this stuff is fundamentally political, and that's the substance of what is going to make or break any review.
Thanks.
Thank you. Alexander?
Thanks, convener, and thanks for the comments so far.
as you've identified, it gives us a chance for a moment to take stock, I think, of where we are and you know, the deadlines that may be coming through some of the processes. And the whole idea of governance and in enhanced cooperation, because I think there are elements that need to be looked at and could be expanded and could be looked into. But if that is to happen, there would need to be, once again, agreement about the structures and the commitments. And that could be quite limited in some respects, but it could also be quite wide-ranging in others if there is to be a flavour. And you've also, Janet, talked about the dates and the timescales we have here with elections and the time it takes to try and make that happen. So there is once again going to be a gap of where we are and what will eventually become the norm for 25 onwards in reality. And it may be slightly different to what we have at the present moment in time, in many respects, depending on the political will and the involvement. So it would be quite good to get a flavour from you of, you know, do you see the enhanced governance or the enhanced cooperation being barriers to the future, or once again, are there some opportunities? I don't mind two answers first.
Yes, happy to go first. I think Brexit is a process, and the TCA implementation is ongoing. I think a good sign is that now, post the Windsor Framework Agreement, both the EU and the UK have been very clear that they are committed to fully implementing the agreement and kind of maximising the potential of the agreement that we have. So I think in terms of a review that is maybe not overly ambitious, but more kind of in the moderate scale, the things that the two sides could easily look at either as part of a review or before it, is to just look at what have we actually already agreed on, but we just haven't implemented it yet. And I think there are various things in the TCA. There are dialogues in there that are encouraged, for example, on security matters, which kind of given the security context that we find ourselves in, seem quite pertinent. So two of those have so far been implemented on cybersecurity and on counterterrorism. But there are three more in the TCA that are suggested and that haven't been yet implemented. There's also a broader article on global cooperation, which is Article 770, which lists various areas for dialogue, including peace and security, sustainable development, climate change. So that's something that the two sides could look at and say, there is already a hook here in the TCA. Could we have more dialogues on that? You mentioned the importance of the governance of the TCA and the governance framework that we have. The Partnership Council, for example, has the power to add new specialised committees to this governance framework or to change the tasks that the specialised committees have, the areas that they look at. And as members might be aware, there has been a proposal in one of the discussions of the PPA, the Parliamentary Partnership Assembly, that there should be a new specialised committee on net zero. So I think those are things that are probably fairly uncontroversial, that if there is kind of momentum and willingness on both sides, the two sides could look at. And then on the more kind of ambitious side of things, you then have a review where you actually add new things to the TCA, like an SPS deal or something on mutual recognition of professional qualifications. And I think if you do that, then it's necessarily going to be a more difficult process because this will require negotiations. So it's quite likely that you will need a new mandate for the Commission to negotiate this on behalf of member states. And that is just going to take more time. You also kind of then touch upon questions of alignment, which might be politically difficult for the UK side. So I think when it comes to those things, the time frame is a bit longer, but there are things that could be done just to kind of act on as yet unfulfilled commitments in the TCA and to look how can we use the framework that we have as best as possible.
Thank you. And Joe?
Yeah, so I think this spirit of cooperation which has been created post-Windsor is good if you want to, so to speak, optimise the TCA and the current agreement, but it's not particularly good if you want to really enhance and deepen the agreement. So to give examples of that, you know, as you said, we've had Horizon, we've had some things which already contained and committed to in the TCA have now been pursued and completed because relations are unfrozen. And so you can piecemeal build upon those things which are already provided for, sit down in your committees and work through them at quite a technical level until you reach conclusion and you implement. We've also had agreements on financial services. There's an MOU on cooperation on competition matters as well, these kind of things. But if you really want to, you know, push the envelope and go into areas which aren't necessarily already provided for, then the current structure of cooperation, I think, is still quite constraining. The reasons for that are the TCA provides for a number of technical committees, but they really are quite technical. You get sort of stuck into the policy detail around, for example, through what methods can you enhance your energy trading provisions. But this is kind of official level work. You've not got politicians in the room who are going to, you know, actually at the end of the day, sit down over a drink and say, is this really where we want to be? Or do we want to take it that bit further and can kind of enhance the scope of imagination, and also in the way that it's governed between the 27 member states. They still meet regularly to kind of discuss UK relations, but again, in quite a structured, staid environment where kind of everyone wants to put their point across officially on the record, but you haven't got that softer, more candid space again. And just to give some examples of the limitations of that, you know, we had this deal recently signed on cooperation on policing irregular migration between the Home Office and the EU's Frontex. Again, there's operational cooperation now going on. We've got a little bit closer in terms of speaking to one another, but there was no really substantial new legal obligations to one another. There's no returns agreement, which has been spoken about as an interest from the UK side. To do that, you really need to, again, like have that show that kind of, I guess, more political trust. You need to kind of be sitting down in different rooms, not just technical committees, where you look someone in the eyes and say, what can we actually do here? What do you need from me? And you go ahead and you work from that. And so that's what's missing in the relationship, and how you create that, you know, is ambiguous. It can be, but broadly speaking, you need to have more regular dialogue. You need to either have more regular political level summits between leaders or other forums as well. You know, you need to have more dialogues which bring politicians together into the room. And also there's a role for diplomats here. The UK mission in Brussels, inviting member states regularly to events, kind of getting to know people, getting to understand people, that softer world of the relationship can be significantly deepened and is a prerequisite to having a much more ambitious relationship with the EU.
And, you know, I think you've identified there that the two sides seem to have more success when finding an agreement, when there seems to be a little bit of a lighter touch in the dialogue that takes place, rather than the formal objections and obligations that come through, because these at times have been much more strained. But as I say, the lighter touch seems to work for both, and we seem to have managed to get a better understanding or even a slightly better process out of all of that. And having other individuals in the room rather than just the political ones, like you've indicated, the diplomats and others who have a role to play, that seems to have a more success. So do you see that as being one of the major features going forward as well?
Yeah, to be clear, this cooperation which has been built in the past 12 months is not a bad thing if you want a closer relationship with the EU. It's a prerequisite to any kind of enhancement. If you can't even talk at a technical and operational level, there's absolutely no hope of doing anything beyond that. I think the analogy which I would give is that kind of, you know, relations were subterranean for a good while after the TCA was concluded, and then we had the impasse over the Northern Ireland Protocol. We've now kind of come back above ground. I guess the aeroplane is is taking off. It's kind of gradually kind of gaining height. But I think that the cruising level where you actually want that relationship to be on a regular basis hasn't yet been found. And so there's a question of at what altitude you want to cruise, I suppose, to really torture the metaphor. But that's where we are.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bibby.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel, and thank you for your report. I particularly note what you've said about the contrast and key differences between the Conservative government's approach and a potential future Labour government around veterinary standards, mutual recognition of conformity assessments and professional qualifications, more flexible labour, mobility arrangements for short-term trips and UK association with EU programmes. I also note what you've said in your report and again this morning about the significant challenges about making changes and the, you know, the potential political costs as well. As a starting point, though, can I ask, to what extent are those differences and that contrast understood in European capitals? And you've also made the point that the EU would also have to trust that future UK governments into the future would, which could be far more Eurosceptic, will uphold such agreements. Just want to ask what can be done to try and address that, those concerns.
Do you want to direct?
To either, sorry.
I'm happy to make a start.
Thank you.
I think just on I'll start with the question to what extent the kind of differences of preference in UK politics are well understood in the EU. I think that, well, on the one hand, I think we've already made the point that the relationship with the UK is not a priority matter for the EU. If you look at meetings of the European Council, there's one next week. If you look at the agenda, they are going to discuss things like Ukraine, the Middle East, enlargement, their new defence industrial strategy. So that's where their heads are at. So I think in terms of their priorities and what they want to drive forward, it's not improvements to the TCA. But at the same time, you still have quite similar structures in the EU institutions that are similar to what they were during the Brexit negotiations, that still very closely monitor what's happening in the UK. So I would say that in those kind of, in the European Commission, in the External Action Service, and also in the working group on the United Kingdom in the Council, which still meets twice a week, there is a very good understanding of the political situation in the UK and what's happening and what the potential positions might be. And I think this is maybe slightly anecdotal now, but I think just also in terms of working at the think tanker, there's definitely a feeling that there is interest in the institutions and in what people in the Labour Party in particular are thinking and what they might want to do if they win the next general election.
Thank you.
Yeah, kind of building on Janneke's point, really, I agree there's the EU definitely understands that Labour has an interest in deepening relations and the differences between the Labour Party and the Conservative Party on that front. I think the two ambiguities that remain are the extent of Labour's understanding of European politics and the extent of Labour's handle on the policy detail. So politics first, kind of a widely sort of said thing is there's an assumption that you turn up in Brussels with a smiley face and suddenly everyone wants to talk to you because you're not the Eurosceptic party that's been in government. But obviously it's a lot more, there are many more vested interests than that amongst the 27 that you have to balance, and you have to understand that if you push on one thing, that's potentially going to upset particular member states, and how do you find a compromise which is going to work for everybody? Which then leads into the policy question, which is, does Labour just say, you know, we want an SPS deal or we want mutual recognition of professional qualifications, but that can take a number of different forms, and it's not clear that that detail has been kind of fully outlined or thought through yet? Because to give an example with SPS, there's a big difference between Swiss-style alignment and New Zealand-style alignment. The Swiss model involves dynamic alignment with EU regulation, and then you remove more or less all bureaucracy around it, or you can have a more limited New Zealand form of alignment where you don't have all the regulatory dynamic alignment, but there's some recognition of standards which allows for some minimization of bureaucracy. And putting those clear asks on the table is going to be the really, really key thing. Firstly, to show that you're a serious negotiator and you understand what you're talking about, because these are technical negotiations which take time. And so the EU is not going to want to sit down with a party unless, you know, it really has a handle on the detail. We saw in the previous negotiations over the TCA and the withdrawal agreement that there was a massive difference in worldview between the UK and the EU on these matters, and generally a perception the UK didn't necessarily always understand exactly what it was kind of getting itself into. And so showing that kind of proficiency in detail is vital. And then it's also important that, again, if it's the Labour Party would understand the trade-offs that come with that. If you're signing up to a Swiss-style veterinary agreement, is it Switzerland or Norway? I'm now getting worried that I'm getting the country wrong. So apologies if so. I think Swiss, but I might mean Norway. No, I do mean Norway. I think I mean Norway. Sorry. Whichever one you're aligning with, that you understand the political trade-offs that come with that, the amount of alignment you're going to have to do, and again, the political ramifications that would potentially come from that domestically, you know, if a government is going to align with a number of EU regulations. I think it is Swiss anyway. Again, the politics that would come back into that is another important feature. And it's not clear at the moment that Labour necessarily is exactly clear on the precise details of the proposals it would like to bring forwards and the consequences that come from that.
Thanks very much for that answer. Obviously, as has been mentioned earlier, it's a big year in terms of politics and elections. With a UK general election, we've also mentioned the European elections as well. In terms of external factors, we have the elections in the United States as well, and I think that's been referenced as a potential external factor that might drive changes between the UK and EU's relationship going forward. And obviously we've heard as well about foreign security agreements and the desire from the EU to work on that as well. Have you any reflections on and thoughts on factors in relation to the United States election and how that could impact on foreign security issues and anything else for that matter?
Yeah, I'll go again then hand over to Yannick, who I think is sort of a bit more across the foreign security stuff than me. But what I would just say is, yeah, the political context has changed even since we wrote that report 6 months ago, I think, in terms of the likelihood of a second Trump presidency, and also the extent to which the EU is really now linking economic policy to security policy, and the extent to which its industrial strategy is linked to security in a more unstable global environment. So the desire to pursue, you know, more domestic manufacturing of industrial capacity around renewables, around critical minerals, forming agreements with other like-minded partners there to help drive that transition to become less dependent on countries like China. And so those questions are fundamentally interlinked, and that's a fundamental difference which didn't exist in 2020 when the TCA was previously negotiated. So that's potentially an area to examine and deepen, because it's a new question which has come onto the agenda. And is it possible that, you know, the EU, again, with this interest in de-risking around China, is looking for other potential partners who are closer to home, share values? Could the UK be one of those partners? Is there more cooperation which could be built in that area? Potentially, but it also depends on a UK interest in a similar form of an industrial strategy. And at the moment, I think with the current government, it's a little bit unclear exactly what their strategy is. It feels like we get occasional mentions of it, but it ends up on ice. So were potentially after the next election either government to come forward with a clearer vision for what it wants to do around these questions, potentially there's room for cooperation with the EU then, but it is, yeah, very much dependent on the politics of the next government.
Thank you, sorry.
To that.
I can hear you. We can't see you at the moment in the room. That's it. Great. Thank you.
Okay. Perfect. If I could add to what Joelle just said, I mean, it's interesting if you look back at the Brexit negotiations. As you know, there is no foreign security and defence chapter in the TCA, even though there was quite a detailed proposal for that in the political declaration, which outlined kind of a joint vision for the future of the relationship and was signed by both sides. And then later, the idea of a chapter on these areas was rejected by the Boris Johnson government. The EU side was quite shocked by that, I think, and they think that was a missed opportunity not to have anything on that in the TCA. So I think there would definitely be interest in that on the EU side. We, of course, know that Labour is talking about the idea of a security pact with the EU. So there's interest on both sides, I think, in doing more together. The question is just how is that actually going to look like? I think on foreign policy, it's probably mainly going to be around having more political dialogue. The EU has political dialogues with almost all of its key partners, and it has also committed in the Strategic Compass, which is the EU's foreign affairs strategy that was released in 2022. In that strategy, the EU has also committed to having a greater focus on foreign security and defence in its dialogues with key partners. It obviously now also has a trade and technology council with the US. So in a way, the UK is a bit the odd one out by not having such a dialogue. So I think that would be a fairly obvious thing to do, which both sides might be interested in. Labour have also said that they're interested in a more formalised relationship on sanctions. Obviously, the two sides are already working very closely on sanctions in response to the Russian war in Ukraine. But that's something they could think about, having a more structured dialogue to kind of maintain the level of engagement also beyond this phase of the war. So that's kind of the foreign policy side. When it comes to defence, the EU has certain instruments that the UK could participate in. That's, for example, the EU's civilian and military missions. The UK used to lead some of those, for example, the one in Somalia, the anti-piracy mission, or in the Western Balkans. So there is a possibility there for the UK to return to some of those missions, albeit in a different role, because as a non-member state, the UK would no longer have any decision-making capacity in contributing to those missions. There are other things that the EU is doing in defence, and they've actually developed lots of new instruments and innovated in response to Ukraine, but also in response to Brexit. So there is the permanent structured cooperation, the so-called PESCO defence projects, where the UK has already applied to participate in one project on military mobility, which is about moving troops and equipment across borders in the EU. As I understand, that's currently being held up by disagreements with one member state, but that will hopefully come to fruition at some point in the future. And I think where it gets really tricky, and which would be the most important area, though, to kind of respond to also the potential of a second Trump presidency, is defence industrial cooperation. The EU just published a new defence industrial strategy last week. And if you look at that strategy, but also at existing funds like the European Defence Fund, which is funded by the EU budget and has 8 billion in there over 7 years, the UK is at the moment excluded from these developments because they focus on enhancing the competitiveness of the single market, and therefore only single market members can really meaningfully participate in those instruments at the moment. So that's member states and Norway, and they're currently also carving out some exceptions for Ukraine for good reasons. But it's going to be difficult for the UK to participate in those things. So I think for a Labour government that wants a security pact, just to kind of have awareness what the constraints are that they have to navigate as a third country that's not in the single market, is going to be important. But I agree with Joel that kind of the international context, and if Trump is re-elected, is going to be a driver for probably having at least something symbolic quite quickly if Labour comes into government.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Brown.
Yeah, thanks very much for your contribution so far. I was interested in what Joel had to say about the constraints, administrative bandwidth constraints on political ambitions. However, I think it's also true, certainly in my experience, that politics drives these things. We have the idea that the EU is a rules-based institution which slavishly follows the rules, but whilst we were discussing animal feeds and so on, Brexit happened and blew all that away. I think in the context of the accession of an independent Scotland, it will be the politics that drives it and not any rules. And also, if you look at what's happened in Ukraine, the way they've climbed up the league table very quickly to accession status, again, it's a response to the politics rather than anything else. Given that, I just wonder if you could say a bit more. I mean, Neil Wibby has quite rightly asked about a Trump presidency. It would be interesting to know whether a UK government in the future would stick with a Trump presidency that was encouraging Russia to attack European states, or would it be more driven to work more closely with Europe? But in relation to two other things, one, the European Parliament elections, is there anything that you can see on the horizon that's politically kind of taking place just now that might make it more difficult to affect changes to the TCA, for example, in a particular country, a particular party with a very strong view on something which might impact the TCA? And I know that's a little bit of crystal ball gazing. And the other one is just in relation to defence and security. Again, are there things which may happen which have a substantial impact? It's obviously difficult to say how either the Middle East plays out in relation to the EU's response or further developments in Ukraine. But are there things that you can see in the horizon that might make it or might have an impact on the ability to change the terms of the TCA by interests of one or more of the 27 or for defence and security developments? Joel first, if possible.
Sure, yeah, absolutely. Okay, I mean, there's almost infinite things that you could try and forecast. So I'll pick out a couple that I think are salient. One is political, and one is more policy based. So I think an important political development recently has been kind of the shift in the EPP bloc in the European Parliament, which is Ursula von der Leyen's bloc, around asylum migration politics and kind of the potential discussion of a Rwanda-style scheme for irregular migration being implemented at a European level. I think that potentially changes the framework for dialogue around migration in the future if the UK looks like less of an outlier in its current approach to wanting to deal with channel crossings or asylum seekers, then potentially that opens the door for closer cooperation on that issue, and again potentially some kind of more formalised returns agreement, probably involve the UK taking in asylum seekers from the EU in exchange perhaps for returning people crossing the channel back to the European Union. So I think that's one area where there's perhaps growing alignment in political attitudes and potentially creates room for dialogue, but it is very much dependent on the identity of both the UK government and the Commission after the next elections. The other one is slightly more prosaic and it's more technical, but it's just the ongoing kind of EU policymaking process, in particular around green matters. So there are a number of big files on the agenda at the moment to do with, for example, packaging waste, quite significant changes to those rules, to eco-design, which is the sustainability of products, also to supply chain regulations around links to forced labour, links to deforestation, links to human rights and environmental abuses. All these things potentially create quite significant new trade bureaucracy between the UK and the European Union, and also potentially because of the protocol / Windsor framework between Great Britain and Northern Ireland. And so this is very technical stuff. No one's really paying attention to it. But, well, actually, no, industry is paying massive attention to it because they're across it. But at a political level, we're not paying much attention to it. But it's a slow drip of issues which are going to create new regulatory barriers. And that is a political problem at the end of the day. And so as these things grow and grow and grow, there's going to be a stronger imperative for a UK government, if it wants to improve its trading links with the EU, to try and nullify those effects. So either that means alignment with the EU regulation, or it means some other kind of way of getting around it. I don't know what that would be, but I could imagine that being kind of an issue which doesn't really drop off the agenda, especially because of the sensitivities in Northern Ireland, which it risks creating, and that's not something that a UK government can afford to avoid.
Janneke?
Yes. I think, I agree with Joelle, and just to say that in terms of the European Parliament elections, I think it's just interesting to think about how that might impact priorities in the EU. At the moment, we are expecting an increase in seats for the far right groups, so the European Conservatives and Reformists, and the ID group, that's the far right of the Parliament, are expected to gain seats. Whilst groups like the Greens, for example, are expected to lose seats, the kind of grand coalition in the European Parliament between the centre-right, the centre-left and the Liberals is expected to hold, but it's expected to be smaller than it currently is. So that means there is a bit of a question mark around kind of coalitions in the European Parliament when it comes to particularly green and environmental files, and whether the EPP groups or the centre-right might be inclined to work with the European Conservatives and Reformists, the ECR group, on those issues, which is going to make it much harder to pass kind of Green Deal legislation through the European Parliament. So I think that might then also have kind of an impact on what the EU wants to do with external partners. I think we're also currently seeing that the next commission, and also Ursula von der Leyen, is currently positioning herself under kind of the areas of defence, but also competition. So I think that's of interest as well, because at the moment, as I said in my previous contribution, it doesn't look as if they've kind of carved out a space for UK participation in their defence industrial strategy. But if Donald Trump is re-elected and actually withdraws the security guarantee for Europe, and if we were to be in a situation where Russia tests the NATO solidarity clause, then I think that would be a very strong incentive for the two sides to fundamentally rethink their security relationship. And for the EU to kind of move on that, because I think we're currently in the kind of slightly paradoxical situation where the UK is kind of a unique partner for the EU in Europe with strong military capabilities. But because of how the EU works and because of the distinction it draws between members and non-members, it currently doesn't really have the tools to acknowledge that. So I think that is going to be interesting to see, and that could be driven by external developments.
Thank you.
Mr. Ruskell?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I wanted to ask you about the issue of EU electricity market reforms, which are aiming to stabilise electricity prices across the EU, particularly after the disruption we've seen with the war in Ukraine. I did notice in your report you talk about some of the tensions within the EU, particularly around subsidy through contracts for difference of French nuclear, and whether that constitutes a subsidy to a major form of energy generation and I guess an economic advantage to France. I'm just wondering, does that have any implications for the TCA and the level playing field at all? Who would like to come in on that? Joe?
I don't think Janneke will mind if I take this one. So there's two implications. Again, one is a policy implication, like last time, and one is a political implication. I think to start with the policy element, so it says in the TCA that there is a commitment to improving the flow of energy between the UK and the European Union, because the UK is no longer a part of the single electricity market the EU has. And so what that means is there is slightly more technical procedure around energy trading on the kind of the daily markets. It's not a significant hindrance, but it is an administrative cost, which is, you know, estimated to be adding perhaps a couple of percent to overall energy prices, perhaps less than 1%. People are undecided, but there's probably a small but not totally insignificant cost to the disruption it creates. And the UK and EU are currently talking about this and how you can get around it. It's going on at technical level, at committee level under the TCA, but agreement hasn't yet been found because it requires, you know, some, there are very few people, I think, that really understand in great detail the kind of the energy policy and how this would work and how you actually create a new mechanism which allows the trading to work more fluidly. But that's ongoing, but it's struggling to really make progress. And there is kind of frustration on multiple sides about how long this has taken, which again comes back to the point I made before, that when you don't have that much kind of political engagement, these things can get a little bit mired in the details and can be kind of slow to move forwards. And so this links to energy market reform, because, you know, were the UK or EU to do something quite dramatic in terms of reforming the energy markets, which for a while seemed likely, but I think seems increasingly unlikely now as the disruption caused by Ukraine, the war in Ukraine, kind of settles down a little bit. There was talk for a while of quite radical reform to de-link renewable prices from fossil fuel prices, for example. But were something radical to happen, that could again complicate the process through which you try and improve the efficiency of your trading. But I think that's a diminishing risk for the time being. So really the issue is around political will and kind of getting that agreement over the line. Of course, in 2026, the chapter on energy has to be renewed anyway. So that might be a point at which a point for more critical reflection on whether enough is being done. And then kind of the second point, which is around the level playing field. Yes, that is, I wouldn't say it's an elephant in the room, but it's interesting how unacknowledged it is. The fact that since, again, Russia's full-scale invasion of Ukraine in 2022, we've kind of seen significant subsidies on the EU side to support energy manufacturers, support industry, the heavy industry that's reliant on, you know, massive use of energy. Those subsidies are to an extent distortive in terms of their effect also within the EU single market. The capacity that Germany and France has to levy national level subsidies is significantly more than a country like Slovakia or Slovenia, and arguably it creates an unlevel playing field within that European market. And equally, you could say between the UK and the EU based on the level playing field provisions in the TCA. For the time being, neither side has really wanted to raise or address that question, it seems. I don't know what's going on behind closed doors, but certainly publicly, it's not been widely raised. And, you know, there is a question about if there were to come a point of a review of the TCA or wider discussions on altering the state of the relationship, would that LPF issue be raised either, you know, as a potentially as a kind of negotiating card to say, okay, look, we've given you a bit of allowance here, we haven't raised any issues. The UK could say, so, you know, you need to give us something back in return, or it could be more as a stick, more as a threat. I don't know, but it is sitting there and it's simmering and it hasn't really been fully discussed, I think.
Okay. No, thanks for that. And I suppose the politics comes into that as well, the appetite within Europe to push through major radical reforms might end up stretching that relationship. I just had one question, really, and a final question. It was really about, you know, I think you've set out really so three particular types of, you know, improvements. I mean, you've talked about an examination, an exploitation, an expansion of the TCA. In that, if we did go down a route of expanding the TCA and changing it quite significantly, do you see any kind of situation where the discussion around our exclusion from the single market comes back onto the table again? Or is this review so tightly constrained that it's unimaginable that such a thing could be entertained? Because it feels to me like there's an inevitable logic here of where we end up, and it might take 5 years, it might take 20 years or 30 years, but within all these models, it's all about removing barriers, it's all about closer integration. It's all about deeper cooperation. And it feels like it's only going in one way, one direction. And surely there can only be one endpoint, which would be a rejoining of the single market. But I don't know if that's just fantastical to even suggest that right now. Yannick, did you want to come in?
I think you might be stretching the crystal balls here, but we'll have a go. Well, so Yannick, please come in.
I think for the TCA review that will take place in 2026, I think it's very unlikely that single market membership is going to be on the table. I think it's not going to be on the table unless the UK side makes a political decision to change its red lines, because at the moment the Labour Party are saying that they are basically committed to the red lines that were set by Theresa May back in 2017, so no single market, no customs union, and no freedom of movement. So unless those red lines are changed, I don't think it's going to be on the agenda for the 2026 review. I think it also in a way clashes with what the EU imagines the review will be, because they obviously see this as a very technical exercise, and even the idea of using it to build on it with an SPS deal or other additions is not really what they have publicly at least said they have in mind. So I think kind of the expand model that we outline in the report, which is not a wholesale renegotiation of the TCA, but just basically a look at what's working, what isn't, and is there anything we could add, because the TCA is, at the end of the day, a dynamic framework agreement, and you can kind of slot new things in if you want to. I think that's probably kind of the maximalist version of what we could see in 2026. And then, of course, further down the line, that might change, but I think that will really depend on politics. And it will probably depend more on politics on the UK side than on the EU side, even though I think also there's a bit of a caveat there, because on the EU side, there's just no appetite on kind of having a conversation about single market membership. I think unless they can be sure that this is something that where there is a broad consensus in UK society and in UK politics, that this is where the UK sees itself for the longer term, because the EU wouldn't want to engage in a negotiation on single market membership, which then is overturned by a future government again.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks.
Is Jill wanting to come in on that question? Or...
Yeah, just quickly, again, absolutely agree with Yannicka on the EU's position on this. But just say, were, you know, in some extreme hypothetical scenario, were the UK to come around and say, we want to rejoin the customs union and the single market, the TCA review would be null and void anyway, that clause, because that's not a review of the TCA, that's an abandonment of the TCA in favour of a fundamentally different form of relationship. So at that point, it would, you know, we're not in the realm of review, which is why kind of when we talk about those three models, those are the TCA review, those are the constraints of how it could be used. Basically, that's as far as you could take it, is deepening the existing treaty. If you wanted to do something fundamentally different, that's beyond review, that's new mandates, that's new negotiations, so forth. But again, just to echo Yannicka's point, that it's politically infeasible, because the EU, even if the UK came around and said, this is what we want to do, the EU wouldn't sign up to it, because there's a lack of trust around the UK's commitment to, you know, fulfilling all the obligations which would be made of it as a member of the single market, and whether not only the current government but future governments, which might be more Eurosceptic in the future, would not simply renege on those obligations. So yeah, I think any kind of progress towards single market, which is far from guaranteed, would come first through steadily building on the existing TCA.
Thank you. I think that's exhausted questions this morning. You've been with us for a long time this morning. Thank you so much for your contributions. It's been really informative. And thank to both Yannicka and Joel individually, but also UK and a Changing Europe for engaging with the committee in our inquiry work. And on that note, I am going to move into private session.